I think that's going to be very, very difficult, although there are elements, you call them good, I call them something else, among the Taliban who have come forward from time to time and say, if only you would do X, we will do Y. And as long as people are prepared to do that, I'm a diplomat, and I think that that President Obama has some instincts in that direction. And certainly, I should have mentioned before, he no talk on AFPAC is complete without mention of the name Richard Holbrooke. I think that Richard Holbrooke meets Art Buchwald's definition of an expediter as someone who confounds confusion with commotion. But in addition to that, I think he's an extremely wily, smart, able negotiator. And he's getting very high marks from people that I speak to in Afghanistan, in Washington, a long way from Afghanistan, about what he's up to and what this new diplomatic initiative of the special envoy, of whom we have two of our most redoubtable diplomats involved. I think that that in the hands of Richard Holbrooke, we might actually be able to make some gains in some circumstances with some elements, some Taliban, but it's going to be very hard. And I hope that we can find a way of winning them over. I think this is going to be hard with the leadership, that we will be able to find a way via the economic development that their base, the people who strap on the suicide vests, will be made narrower.
There are elections scheduled in August in Afghanistan. Do you see any reasonable prospect that someone will replace Karzai and that would be an improvement?
Short answer to the first question, no. And to the second question, I wish there were someone who would emerge who would be more effective than Karzai has been. He was there as the state was reestablished. I think he has now gone beyond, lived beyond his useful political life. I wish him a successful retirement. And but I do not think that is going to happen. There are people who, as individuals, are interesting candidates, but I'm not sure that they would be any better qualified, any better able than he is to run the country. So I think we're going to be dealing with another Karzai term. I do think that his defeat might be possible were the opposition candidates to get together. And yes, in that case, were that to happen, and it would be kind of a two-party, two-candidate election, then I'm sad to say this, but I would vote for kind of anybody, ABK, I guess, in that situation. So, but I think we'll be seeing more of Mr. Karzai.
Statistically speaking, what kind of effect does Sharia law have on violent and nonviolent crimes as compared to, say, the U.S.?
I have no statistics, I'm sorry to say, is the short answer to that question. There are very few countries in which Sharia law is in effect, and it depends on what you mean by Sharia law. There are a lot of executions in Saudi Arabia. There are a lot of executions in the state of Texas also. So if we're talking about that sort of thing, I think that the statistics are not as bad as they are made out to be. But I urge you, you're young, you got your health, as was said in Raising Arizona. I've always liked that line very much. take, what would you want to get a job for, I believe was what followed that, if I remember the in the movie. But I urge you, if you are at all interested, to learn more about Sharia law. There's a great literature on it, and people, there is a tendency to say anybody who speaks about Sharia law as something that could be made to work in the 21st century, that 21st century lawyers could make work in the 21st century in a way that was respectful of people's human and civil rights, that is something that could be done. There are a number of people around in the Muslim world who are interested in doing that, and just to continue beating a horse that is about to expire, the problem is that the extreme things that are said on each side and that are done on each side, nobody's mentioned the absolutely disgusting case that was written up in the New York Times recently of a 47-year-old man in Saudi Arabia who insists on maintaining his marriage to an 8-year-old girl, and having had two courts in Saudi Arabia affirm his right to do so, is grotesque. And there is no reason why actions like that should be used to give the Sharia, which is a set of divine principles, the name that it has received in the West.
Okay, thanks. Today at the City Club of Cleveland, we have been listening to Professor Charles F. Dunbar from Boston University, Professor of International Relations. Thank you very much, Ambassador, and thank you, ladies and gentlemen. This forum is now adjourned.
For information on upcoming speakers or for podcasts of the City Club, go to cityclub.org.